Hi, in this video, I will tell you about changes in urban services and infrastructures over time. The focus is on water and energy. They are so-called essential services because every citizen needs water and energy to survive. Moreover, urban water and energy production, distribution and consumption take up a huge part of a city's environmental footprint. Sustainable development in cities calls for major changes in the infrastructure services for water and energy. But how do we do that? Before we try changing them, we first need to understand the typical social and technical features of these infrastructures. I will give you a brief history of both to show these features, and I will show you that they have quite some patterns in common. In the West, the first piped drinking water and electricity grids were provided as local autonomous networks and grids. We are talking end of the 19th century here, the phase of localization. Private entrepreneurs built small networks and grids to serve their local customers. The first drinking water networks in Amsterdam were built to serve only those citizens in Amsterdam who could afford to have the first water flush toilets in town. And the first electricity networks were built by and for local entrepreneurs on a neighborhood scale. But by the end of the 19th century, many local authorities had taken over the building and management of water networks and electricity grids for reasons of public health, safety, and economic development. This is the start of local and regional network building, increasingly a government affair. Water and energy companies become so-called public utilities, owned by local or regional governments. The decades thereafter, especially after World War II, we can see an upscaling and speeding up of network building. Regional electricity grids become connected through high voltage power lines operated by national transmission system operators. Municipal water companies merge and become provincial entities. The percentages of connections for both water and electricity reach levels of 90 to 100%. This is the phase of nationalization, at the end of which we see large government-owned networks providing water and energy services to their citizens under regional or national monopoly conditions. Utilities have become the single providers of water and energy services. Consumers have no choice but to connect to the major grids. They are so-called captive consumers. And then, roughly around the 1980s, public utilities become contested. A wave of privatization and utility market liberalization causes national and regional utilities to split up, become private service suppliers over the networks and grids that still remain in public hands. We see the entry of new service suppliers, both in water and energy. Companies specializing in niche markets for rainwater harvesting systems or green or low-priced electricity. This is the phase of marketization and splintering grids. We also witness the re-entry of local and individual producers. Consumers who turn into co-providers of solar electricity, communities operating a wind turbine and delivering their electricity back to the grid. Overseeing these developments, we can say that for one, these developments are both institutional and technical. And secondly, they have strong implications for how we deal with our precious resources of energy and water in our daily lives. For instance, the role of consumers has dramatically changed over time, from being considered a connection only, or a captive consumer during the nationalization phase. Consumers have become a valuable target for commercial private service providers in the marketized phase. Next to that, consumers have become co-providers of electricity and water services, sharing these resources via adapted existing networks or new networks. So we have seen that water and energy networks have grown substantially and have become interwoven with urban life. Now they start to diversify in terms of technology, skill, markets, consumer approaches. How does this development of water and energy infrastructures align with environmental innovation? Besides big infrastructures like hydropower plants or offshore wind parks, there is also a tendency to downscaling in sustainable water and energy infrastructures, both in technical and in organizational terms. Renewable energy appliances like solar panels, wind turbines, or combined heat power plants are of a much smaller scale than conventional power plants. Also, environmental innovation in urban water infrastructures means experimentation with local rainwater harvesting or decentralized water treatment systems. So splintered infrastructures and environmental innovations may go hand in hand, and so goes for consumer involvement in the provision of sustainable water and energy services. With the technical diversification and downscaling, there is a need to involve the urban consumer, not as a passive connection anymore, but as an active co-provider of greener services. The grids are opening up, and so do the options for consumers to become involved in sustainable water and energy services. Now, how would you become involved in your energy and water system of provision? Is co-production an option, or would you opt for shared or public schemes for sustainable water and energy provision?